We hand over to Advocate Venara. Ms. Geldenhuys, you were part of a delegation that appeared before Parliament, before this committee on the 7th of December.
That's correct.
And you participated in a walkout of this sitting on the 7th of December. A move quite unprecedented in a democratic South Africa. Is there anything that you want to say to this committee before we start around your participation in the walkout of Parliament?
The only thing I can say, if it offended parliamentarians, I can apologise for that. But I have stood with my chairman, Mr. Professor Magube, in the fact that he felt that he was not being treated constitutionally.
Over to you, sir. You have to members, as you go on, can you contribute to it, or do you want to contribute? I don't want to derail our meeting. I'll afford you an opportunity to contribute when you get your 5 minutes. Honourable Advocate Venara, it is 3:25. Can you go through your part of it by 3 o'clock, and we'll afford members the rest of the time to interact with it. Is that okay? Over to you, sir.
Ms. Geldenhuys, good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
You sent me a 6-page statement. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And that statement is unsigned.
I can sign it for you if I am given the opportunity. I will sign it for you if I'm given the opportunity to do so.
Okay, no, it's fine. You can sign it once we're done.
Thank you.
With your permission, that statement was circulated to members of this committee. Are you comfortable with that?
Absolutely comfortable.
Can you share with the committee your role vis-a-vis the board in your capacity as the company secretary?
Fine. The role of the company secretary is legislated. My role was to provide guidance, to assist the board with its collection of documents, and to be the interaction between the board and management. I produced policies and terms of reference and charters for the committees of the board. Throughout each of its meetings, I gave them guidance where it was necessary, guidance that was given that was not accepted. I cannot answer for that, but I do know that I have tried my best to do my job to the best of my ability and with integrity.
Let's cut to the chase, ma'am. We do not have time. There was a special board meeting convened for the appointment of the COO. What role did you play in that organization of the meeting?
I was informed by the chairman at the time, Mrs. Shabalala, that I need to call board members for an urgent meeting. We sent out an SMS because it was at very short notice, informing them of a meeting that would convene at 7 o'clock, around 7 o'clock that evening on the 7th. When asking about the agenda, I was informed by Ms. Shabalala that the agenda comprised two matters. One was the public protector's report. The other one was the matter of the COO. And I asked her what matter of the COO. She said to me, just the matter of the COO. Prior to the day of the meeting, we had attended the PCC committee on the 4th of July, where the matter of the COO was raised, and I assumed it was that specifically because the item one on the agenda was to be the public protector's report, and I assumed that the next thing would be the matter of the COO in conjunction with the public protector's report. When we got to the meeting, it was something totally different.
at the meeting, the evidence before this committee paints a picture of two different views in the main, with specific reference to the appointment of Mr. Mtsweni. There was one group that had raised quite a number of issues, both substantively and procedurally, regarding the matter that was on the agenda. And there were those who were supportive of it. Is that correct?
That's correct.
One of your role is to provide guidance to the board.
Correct.
There were issues of process related to the HR policies that had not been complied, HR processes that had not been complied with.
May I respond to that? The appointment of executive directors does not go through the normal HR processes per se. The role of the of advertising, etc., stand, but the board does the appointments through appointing agencies to do headhunting and searching for the candidates for that, and they then recommend. It doesn't go through our normal HR processes. It is a board procedure.
My question is,
yes,
in terms of the policies of the SABC, a position has to be advertised.
Correct.
In other words, there has to be a recruitment process.
Correct.
There was no such process in respect of this.
That's correct.
Now, you're not a decision maker at the board. You play an advisory role.
Correct.
When you saw the board going astray in terms of complying with the policies, did you advise them?
I was not given an opportunity to advise. The chairman of the board, as I mentioned, Ms. Shabalala, went straight in and did everything that was done. It was as much as a surprise to me as it was probably to all other members.
I'm saying you at a meeting and your board is busy acting inconsistently with the policies of the organization. You're playing an advisory and governance issues. Did you not deem it appropriate at that meeting to raise this issue?
It would have been appropriate, but you had to be in the meeting to understand the procedures that were taking place. It was not a matter of you being able to stop the chairman to say to her, you're not doing the right thing. She was a very forceful person that would not accept any advice from any other person.
The current position that you occupy, group executive
governance and assurance,
how did you get that position?
I wanted to retire because, as is, you know, I'm of retirement age. Although my contract expires on 30th of April 2017, my intention was to go on pension. And I was requested to fill this position in order to pass on skills to get somebody in as part of the succession planning to upskill people so they could take over that position. The position that I'm of the group executive governance and assurance is a short-term appointment. It is not a five-year contract, as is the norm.
Let's quickly go through the round-robin decisions.
Yes.
Will you agree with me that in a round-robin setup, members of the board are ordinarily deprived of the benefit of other members' insight?
It depends on the particular circumstance. A majority of our round-robin approvals are matters that had served at a board and were statutory matters that had to be approved, for instance, our quarterly report and submissions to the AGM. Where the members were all provided with copies of the documents that had to be submitted. The time that we did have to do a round robin was when the board was not correct and the board would sit and they would discuss the particular item, and because there was no quorum, it was agreed that the matter could be approved on a round-robin basis. There was one particular quarterly report where that opportunity could not arise, and the report had to be submitted to avoid an audit issue. At the subsequent meeting where the round robin was ratified, members had the opportunity to provide input, and we then had to submit a revised quarterly report to the minister.
Ma'am, I didn't ask you about the decisions that were taken through round robin.
Yes.
I'm asking you, in the case of a round robin decision,
yeah,
is it accurate to state that individual members of the board are deprived of the benefit of other members' contributions?
That's why I responded the way I did, because it depends on the type of resolution that is taken on a round-robin basis. For instance, a quarterly report, all people's input is important, all the directors' input is important, and where that is not done in a group sitting, there is a deprivation to other members. But with regard to a statutory matter, for instance, matters that are going to the AGM, for instance, which is the appointment of the auditors and the appointment of the audit committee members, those matters are discussed in the audit committee prior to the submission. So they are not as involved as our quarterly reports.
After the Supreme Court of Appeal, in respect of Mr. Mutsoning's yes. case,
yes.
there was a resolution, a draft resolution that was circulated for round robin decisions. Is that correct?
Correct.
That matter had never served before the board members before.
No, it didn't. That's one of the instances where they could not have a discussion.
Now, in those instances, board member X would not have had insight of the benefit of the wisdom of other board members, either to persuade them or to be persuaded by them. Is that correct?
Correct.
In respect of your governance and how you took decisions, my understanding was that round-robin decisions required the same number of votes. It was just a majority decision.
That's correct. It's a majority decision.
There was no higher threshold.
No. Not, it's the Companies Act allows for the majority of members to be able to approve a matter on a round-robin. A round-robin, the Companies Act gives you the opportunity, particularly when there's a space between meetings, that you can approve something that comes up.
As the person that was advising on governance issues, forget about what the Companies Act says.
Okay.
In view of the fact that some of the decisions would require round robin and on matters that had never served before the board, didn't you think it appropriate to advise the board to increase the threshold for a decision to be taken through a round robin?
The threshold is included in the memorandum of incorporation. It is set by the shareholder. So if I go and ask for a higher threshold, I'm contravening the MOI.
Now, you're not going to go to the shareholder. You are advising the board that for these reasons, in the interest of good corporate governance, this is your advice. Why haven't you done that if you did not do it? If you had done it, when and at which meeting?
You're talking about me advising them on the threshold of the MOI, of the approvals of round robins?
Yes.
I've not advised them on that because we adhere to the requirements of the MOI. That is the statutory document for companies to adhere. The levels of what you do is set out in your memorandum of incorporation.
The documents,
yes,
that the committee requested from you.
Yes.
I understand you're an employee of the board. And the chairperson of the board says, do not submit the documents.
Yes.
You have an advisory role. Did you try and establish from the chairperson what were the reasons?
The reasons for the chairperson not releasing the documents was because of the legal advice he received. And based on the advice that was provided, it was felt that certain documents could not be released.
No. The documents, you initially received a letter requesting the documents. Yes. And those documents were not furnished.
Correct?
Now, why were those documents not furnished?
Because on the advice of legal advice received by the chairman, he recommended that they do not get furnished until such time that the clarity was received in terms of what had to be provided.
Up until the time that you were served with summonses demanding those documents, you have not made any contact with the committee.
It is not in my purview to contact the committee. The protocol and the proper way of doing things is through the chairman and the chairman through the minister to contact the committee.
But your role is to advise your chairman.
My role is to advise the chairman.
Did you advise the chairman that, chairman, we had received a letter from Parliament. We've sought advice. There are certain issues that we cannot disclose. Therefore, we need to inform Parliament that we can't disclose this document. Did you do that?
I did that, and that is why a letter was submitted to Parliament to inform them of the issues that were not going to be submitted to Parliament.
The Memorandum of Incorporation.
Yes.
Gave away certain powers of the board to the executive directors.
Correct.
Was that a good governance practice?
In terms of most companies, that is an operational matter. The appointment of executives within a company is done by the executives of the specific company. In terms of the SABC, there was a lot of kicking against it, and I cannot say the reasons why that was done. It was done by our shareholder. I received a copy of the final memorandum of incorporation, and my role was to ensure that our governance documents were in line with the statutory documents. Included in the DAF, I specifically included a safeguard which stipulates, sorry if I may, just refer you to the DAF, and it's clause G5, G6. And there's a section, the business context sets out that the appointments of all employees is subject to human resources appointment processes, budget approval for the position, the powers to appoint and discipline, and it must be in line with any policy of the HR department.
There's evidence before this committee that subsequent the amendment of the MOI and the subsequent amendment of DEF, there was purging of senior executives.
That does not fall under my watch or anything like that. It's outside of the board matters that I deal with.
I'm raising this because initially these executives had to be appointed by the board and their disciplines had to be attended to by the board in terms of the old MOI, is that correct?
Correct.
Now, subsequent to the amendment, there is an exodus of senior executives. It no longer concerns the board. I get your point. Did it concern you?
Can I reserve answer on that, please?
Because no, you can't.
I can't.
No, you can't. Answer all questions.
A lot of the people who have left, I heard when they left, after they had left. I heard about their leaving after people have left. So the circumstances and the conditions in which they have left, I am not aware of, and I did not participate in the purging of any of these staff members.
Some of these employees that left, were reported in the media, and the circumstances under which they left were reported in the media.
Does not fall under me either. I am not part of the communication area. That is a specific department that does media releases. It is not part of the company secretary's duties.
The point I'm asking, ma'am, is you might not officially have known that so-and-so left. You might not have known the circumstances surrounding the departure of that particular individual in your official capacity. Do you understand?
Correct.
Reading in a newspaper article that a ex-so-and-so was an executive or eight executives have left the SABC and these are the circumstances. Have you ever read something to that effect in the media?
I saw the leaving of the eight executives on television. Briefly, when I watched the news, I saw that. How they left and the reasons for them leaving was the statement was that they left because of not being able to publish matters relating to the burning of property and etc. And they were dissatisfied, and that is why all that process was followed and done, whatever was done there. But as I say again, that does not fall into my role as the company secretary at the time and to advise the board of it.
The public protector report.
Yes.
How was it handled by the board?
The board took a decision to split the public protector's report to the various committees. They set up a committee of chairs with the chairpersons of each of the committees that were dealing with the report, which was the HR committee, the social and ethics committee, the audit committee, and the deputy chairperson at the time, Professor Maguwe. They formed the committee of chairs. And they then had a terms of reference for that committee, and they went through the report and then reported to the board on what their recommendations were. There was quite a bit of conflict between what was going on there. Certain people wanted something to go one way, and another lot of people wanted it to go a different way. And that was the story of the public protector's report. It's one of the biggest rifts of the SABC board.
There's evidence before this committee that Ms. Ellen Shabalala, on receipt of the interim report from the public protector, she did not table it at the board meeting, but she took it upon herself to respond. Were you aware of that?
I was not aware of her responding. I was not aware that there'd been an interim report, because it did not come via the company secretary's office at all. In fact, even the main report, I got a copy through one of the board members, Ms. Rachel Kalidas, because it did not come through the company secretary's report. It's the company secretary department.
When I asked you a question a few minutes back,
yes,
about how you took the issue of the resignation of the senior executives, your answer was you preferred not to comment on that. Is that
yes,
correct?
That's correct.
Until the chairperson intervened.
That's correct.
What is it that you didn't want to tell the committee?
That's not something I don't want to tell, but it's not my place to say anything about how people are leaving the SABC or why they leave in the SABC. There has been justification for their leaving, rightly or wrongly so. I cannot be the judge of that.
No further questions, sir.
You done? Thank you very much. Let's start with Honourable Loliwe, and then we will move to Honourable Fendam. Honourable Loliwe, you've got 7 minutes.
Thanks, Chair. Ms. Geldenhys, do you respect Parliament? And if your answer is yes, why did you decide to miss the deadline of submitting the required documents?
My answer is yes, I do respect Parliament. The deadline of the submission for the for the documents was because of the legal opinion that was received to hold on to it until the committee was reconstituted.
You are indicating that you've been a company secretary for 26 years.
That's correct.
In your 26 years, have you been a champion of a freedom of speech in your institution? And if your answer is yes, how do you explain the fact that when people voiced their views here in this commission, you are saying they are grandstanding? I'm referring to your paragraph before last, first page of your statement.
There is a thing for freedom of speech, but there's also a way that you have to express yourself without making yourself out to be somebody completely above everything else, while you actually lower someone else's character.
If you go to page 5 of your statement, the last paragraph, I think it's almost the last sentence. These utterances have not deterred me and have continued to provide the necessary guidance.
That's correct.
If you were providing guidance, where were you when the board allowed itself to be subjected to, number one, incorrect appointment procedures, flouting of procurement policies, ill-treatment of staff as displayed by the SABC aide, just to mention a few? What role did you play there?
I did not play any role in terms of the flouting of policies. The governance of the board and the committees under the board fall under me. All processes that needed to be reported to the board and approved by its committees were followed. That is, whatever had to come to the board for approval did come. There are other approval processes that are below the level of the board's authority that went wherever it went to. In those instances, if policies were flouted, they needed to be addressed in the committee that deals with such policies, which is the Bid Adjudication Committee. It had to be taken there, and if there was no satisfaction there, it should have been taken to the Group Exco Committee. But these matters never reached the board.
Are you implying that even the permanent appointment of Mr. Mutsweneng as a COO, all procedures were followed, proper processes were followed?
No, I'm not implying that at all. I agree that the proper process did not get followed. I agree that there should have been a recruitment process followed, but as I mentioned previously, the matter was brought to the board with no documentation other than that was read out at the meeting, and that process was followed. At that point, I mean, I am only the company secretary. I do not take the decisions of the board.
On the same page 5, you are quick to mention Mr. Naidu, but the other person is referred to as another board member in the same paragraph I've quoted.
Yes.
Who is this one who is having no name? Why are you quick to mention Mr. Naidu and not mention the other one?
The reason for me mentioning Mr. Naidu is because Mr. Naidu came to the MIT committee and he made the utterances in this committee. The other person did not come into this committee, so I'm not protecting that person. I can provide you with a name.
Are you then saying you are targeting Mr. Naidu because he came here, that's why it's easy for you to mention, and then the other one, because he or she never came here, will be referred to as another person? Provide the name.
That is definitely not my intention to target Mr. Naidu, and I can provide you the name. It was Ms. Mshlagaza, who has constantly referred to me in the meeting as the company secretary and that I must not be allowed to speak at all.
Remember, you have alluded to the fact that your role is to advise the board.
Correct.
Are you able to say currently the SABC does or does not have a board? Because Our understanding is, even with the meetings you have alluded to, if non-executive members were not there to make it to correct, you cannot say it was a constitutional meeting.
That's correct. And currently now we only have two official board members, which is one executive director and one non-executive director. So in the constitution of the board, there is not a board, a valid board. But what can be done is to make that board a valid board is to include additional members to bring it up to a level where you can have a quorum.
Under normal circumstances, in any meeting, a person who can endorse a decision is one who was part of a meeting, say in the following meeting, you can endorse decisions. But somewhere in your statement, but I can't remember the page now, you say when your meetings did not correct, decisions were taken and then endorsed in next meetings when a meeting correct. Which procedure is that? You are guiding the board, remember? That's what correct. You said. Are you the one who gave that guidance?
Yes, I am, and that is a correct procedure. Matters that are dealt with at a board that is not correct can be and are ratified at the following board meeting, which makes them valid.
What name do you give to that sitting that makes the proposal? Because if it is a meeting, it would have been a meeting that correlates, but now you have a collection of individuals who take a decision expecting a proper structure to endorse that. That structure is endorsing decisions of what?
The structure would still remain a board meeting. The fact that there's not a quorum does not take away the fact that it is a board meeting. Because there are not sufficient members to form a quorum, until that decision or resolution is ratified, only then does it become a valid resolution.
Thank you, Honourable Loliwe. Honourable Fanda.
Thanks, Chair. Ms. Geldenhys, in terms of the SABC Charter, you are the central, that's an important word, central source of guidance and advice to the board on matters of business ethics and governance.
Okay.
That would require you to have full knowledge of all legislation and policies related to the SABC. The Broadcasting Act is the act that governs the SABC. And in terms of that act, quorum is 9 members, right?
Including a chair or deputy chair?
Absolutely. And in terms of the Broadcasting Act, it does not allow the board to appoint additional members from, I don't know where, around the corporation and just, you know, pick someone up from an office and say, come, be a board member.
That was not my intention. I said there can be appointment of board members following the Broadcasting Act in terms of how appointments are made for non-executive directors.
Okay, that appointment is made by Parliament,
that's
not the
correct.
Board. Now, in your statement, you say that from the 1st of October, you've been appointed the GE of Governance and Assurance.
That's
now, it's common knowledge that the board ceased to be quorate on the 22nd of September, and this was confirmed by the Western Cape High Court. Therefore, your appointment is unlawful. The board was in quorate.
My appointment was made at a board meeting on the 19th of August, where a fully quorate meeting was held. The fact that I got the contract on the 1st of October and my appointment was done was subsequent to the decision taken at the board meeting on the 19th of August 2016.
No. Since the 1st of October 2016, I occupy the position of GE Governance and Assurance. With the approval of the board, the deputy company secretary succeeded me as a company secretary.
That's correct.
Ma'am, remember you're under oath.
I am.
When
under
was
oath.
Your position approved? On my, the 1st of?
My contract was signed on the 1st of October. The position was approved by the board at its meeting on the 19th of August 2016 by a fully quorate board.
Yes, an appointment is ratified with the signature. So that process would have made your appointment as the GE lawful, that signature on the contract.
That's correct, but the board has approved the appointment, and if an approval is made, that resolution stands.
But if there's no contract, then it doesn't stand. There needs to be a signed contract, which means that your appointment was approved by the was officially approved by the board when it stopped being quorate, and your position is therefore unlawful.
I cannot agree with you. I'm sorry, with due respect. When a resolution is taken, if a board is now no longer quorate or no longer existing, all decisions taken by that board are still valid. Because by the ending of any board that does not mean that resolutions taken prior to the date of their dissolution or the date they are no longer quorate are no longer valid.
Who signed the contract on the board side on the 1st of October?
The board does not sign the GE governance's contract.
Who signed your contract?
The contract was signed by the CFO, CEO, the acting GCO, and the HR
Okay, executive. Let's move on from this. I disagree with you. I think your appointment is unlawful. Are you a director of a company along with Mr. Motsuneng called Rugby Broadcasting?
Sorry, Kurwa?
Are you a director of a company?
No, I'm not a director. I'm the company secretary of Rugby Broadcasting, which is a dormant company of the SABC. And we've been struggling to get this company deregistered for 3 years now after the approval obtained by the Minister of the Communication and the Minister of the National Treasury, which is the process that has to be followed in terms of the PFMA. So I am the company secretary there. Mr. Motsuneng at the time was the only director of that. It's a dormant company which is supposed to have been closed or deregistered by SABC. In the time of the previous board, the process was already approved and started and submitted to SABC.
All right. The company is listed, you and Mr. Motsuneng are listed as directors, and it's still active. And it's listed, in fact, as a private company, not...
It is a subsidiary of the SABC. There's the Rugby Broadcasting, there's the Skenia, and there's the Airwaves Travel Companies that are subsidiaries that were incorporated in accordance with the PFMA as subsidiaries of the SABC. Because the companies are dormant, they are being deregistered. The submission, the document, the full documentation with the approval has been with SABC. It's been resubmitted 3 times already for them to deregister. It is now they've eventually accepted everything and are in the process of deregistering the companies.
What's the role of Rugby Broadcasting, or was the role of Rugby Broadcasting?
The intention of the role of the Rugby Broadcasting would have been for the broadcasting of sports rights, but this goes back to a long time prior to the full incorporation of the SABC as it is now.
All right. Can I just make the point that in your apology you said, if I offended Parliament? I don't know about the rest of the committee, but I don't consider that an apology. Walking out of a parliamentary sitting is highly disrespectful, and you should have apologized. I note that the delegation that was with you here on the 7th is back. There's 17 people from the SABC. Who are these people? Who is paying for them to be here? And what role are they serving by being in this meeting?
They have attended the meeting to be part of this delegation so they can give any answers that Parliament may need from them.
They have not been summoned by this committee.
No, they have not been, yes.
Yes, so the same delegation now is back again. For what purpose? And who's paying for these trips that this delegation is taking to come to Parliament for meetings that they're not invited to?
The support system that has come, I think they are here as witnesses for Parliament. Not
a show of force.
Not a show of force. No, we have not come here in a force to say anything. That is not the intention of anything like that.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much, Honourable Chauke.
Thank you very much, Chair. Let me first find out, how did you compile this document?
My report?
Yes, this paper here.
That I wrote it myself. I wrote it based on what the comments that were being made, as well as in order to let you know exactly what my role is as the company secretary, and to address the allegations against me that were being made out there with like various people.
Parliament gave you an opportunity to be present here during the presentation of witnesses. You decided to leave because you have not done your work. your work obviously entails you having to prepare documentation both for the chair, meaning that the board, and the executive. You have not done your work. Hence, you came here and you remain silent to the fact that you do have a system that helps Prof. Maguve when it comes to Braille. You are in this house here and you left without informing us of that capacity that we have, which is your role. Can you comment on that?
I can comment on that. As Parliament works, as you invite somebody to speak, you did not invite me to talk, and I cannot, if I stand up from my experience and what I've seen in Parliament, I cannot stand up and make statements unless invited to do so.
What is your role? Your role is not to advise the board. And when the chair of the board is called upon or is raised a concern, what you're supposed to do?
I sent an email to Ms. Cindy Bali, asking her to submit the documents in Word to me, and that is what I've done. The documents had not been submitted at the time. The only thing that was received was the notification of the Professor Maguve's attendance and the program. So any letters that he wanted had not yet been received.
Which documents that and why you did not give certain documents to Parliament? And what is your understanding of the role of Parliament?
My understanding of the role of Parliament is to ensure that governance continues in the country and to uphold the laws of the country.
To hold you accountable.
And to hold me accountable.
Accountable and to appear when you're called upon by Parliament.
I am here and I've been...
So are you part of the fraction of which a board members? Because by now I think having followed what was happening on TV... Have you completed this document now? You now know that that board was divided. What was your role and which part of the group that you belong to in that board?
With due respect, Honorary Chauke, I do not belong to any faction. My role is to remain completely independent of whatever goes on in the board. I do not take sides. I do not favor one above the other. I do my job independently and with integrity.
Are you aware of a mismanagement at the SABC, a fraud, corruption, mismanagement of public money, a looting of state resources at the SABC as recorded because you have been following the processes? And what is your take on that?
I did not follow all the processes.
Why specifically do you choose not to hear about this one?
It's not only that one, because I was busy. I have been working as well, doing what I had to do. And that is what I was doing. And the other part is that I have stopped being the company secretary. I've been trying to assist to provide the documents that are required.
So where you are sitting, do you think that you are adding value to SABC? Where you are sitting now, do you think that you are adding value?
For me being here, I've been called to be here. And I respect the fact that I've been called to be here. That is why I'm attending. And because I do respect Parliament and its wishes, I have come to be here to be questioned on everything that you discuss.
Are you adding value into the company, which is the SABC, where you are seated to be very honest, loyal to this country, and are you satisfied that the money that we pay you as a salary every month is valued of the work that you are doing in that board?
I sincerely believe that, because the work that I do has uplifted what this board has done in the past. There were no processes, there were no procedures, there were no policies, there were no record keeping, nothing. So I firmly believe that I definitely have added a lot of value to the SAP.
So have you resigned in the company that both you and Mr. Mutsuning are directors? Have you resigned?
I have resigned as the company secretary of it because... And that company has been, the process of deregistration has been taking place for the past 3 years. And it is not as if Mr. Mutsuning and I are directors. I am not a director of that company. I'm the company secretary of it.
So, when are you retiring?
I have already reached retirement age. I have a contract When I started with the SABC, I was given a 5-year contract, and that was from the 1st of May 2012, and it expires on the 30th of July 2017. As I mentioned earlier, I wanted to retire now when I changed.
When are you retiring? That's the question I'm asking you.
I have been asked to have a short-term contract to provide skills transfer, to improve governance processes, and to make the governance of the...
Okay, so are you transferring skills to who?
That there are quite a number of people within the organization.
Who? The number? Who's your immediate person that you are transferring the skills to?
There's one person that I've transferred.
Are you teaching her on how to respond to Parliament?
I'm sorry, Mr. Honorary Chauke. I don't know if you can teach someone how to respond to Parliament. But I'm sure with her being here, she will learn how to respond.
Thank you very much.
Honourable Kilian.
Thank you, Chairperson. Chairperson, through you, Ms. Geldenhuys, first of all, I have to just make the comment that we find it completely unacceptable as members of Parliament to have what we term malicious compliance with our request to supply documents. For us to receive from Saturday onwards until now about approximately 400 documents, not a comprehensive list, not properly ordered, not stating what are the minutes, etc., etc., round robin resolutions, just forwarding a whole host of documents to us, we regard that as a further extension of contempt of Parliament. How should we apply our minds sifting through those documents? So that is just by way of introduction.
Do you want
to comment on that?
Yes, I would like to respond. As I mentioned, I could not release the documents. I'm not the owner of the documents. When I had my interview with Advocate Venara, I expressed to him that there are hundreds of documents that the committee is asking for. What are they going to be doing with all these documents? Is there something specifically that they want that I can arrange for them to get that? Okay, that was the thing. With me sending the documents, I spent all the time putting them into an order, numbering the documents in batches, sending a covering email to say what has been submitted and what has not been submitted, and I have sent that, there's a list of it over there, saying exactly as per the summons that was issued, what documents are being submitted. There are hundreds of documents that are comprised the 3 years. So all those things, I tried to put it in a number order so that it could make easier reference to the secretary. And
okay,
no
can
other
we
way
please proceed? Chairperson, through you. Just by way of interest, if you saying that you are giving advice to the board and that you're relying very heavily on the Companies Act, just as a matter of interest,
Yes. Obviously
shareholders have an absolute right to access to documentation. So it is not any favor that is being done to suppliers with documents. This is a national public broadcaster. We have every right to ask access to documentation. We have not received all of it, and we take a dim view that an attorney appointed, we don't know when, is now stating and telling us what we are entitled to and what not. But we will get to that later on. Chairperson, as in terms of the very Companies Act, the duties of the company secretary is very clear. 10.2 says, providing the directors of the corporation collectively and individually with guidance as to their duties, responsibilities, and powers. 10.2.2, making the directors aware of any law relevant or affecting the corporation. Can you please tell us what you have done when 3 board members, after a report ostensibly compiled by you, we don't know at whose instruction, 3 board members were irregularly removed from the board, not only by non-executive directors, which is completely against the Public Broadcasting Act, but also voted on by executive directors with a direct interest in that.
Can you please explain what your advice to the board was on that occasion?
In terms of...
Sorry, ma'am, before you do that, the question that she's asking, she doesn't know by who. We want to know who asked you to do a review on your principles.
First of all, let me correct it. That was not a review. There was also a statement that I did an investigation. There was a parliamentary question that was responded to as well. It was never a review or an investigation. The minister in a meeting, there was a complaint. The members were discussing the behaviour of the board at a meeting, and the minister asked me to write a report on what the behaviour was. And all that was submitted to the minister was the lack of attendance of members at board meetings, the lack of cooperation between board members, and that was it. There was never an investigation into any board member.
Why did you not supply the relevant board members upon their request with a copy of that report that you submitted about them to the minister?
Because it is not my document, it is the minister's document. And I have no right to give out ministers' documents.
Hold on. Ms. Geldenhuys.
Yes?
You are under oath.
I know that.
The company acts as you are accountable to the board, not to the minister. Now, you're saying to us that the minister asks you to do something. Your principal, to whom you are accountable, you jump the principal, you go to the minister. And you're saying to us that, well, the minister asked you to do that. The company act says you are accountable to the board. You are not accountable to the minister. Can you explain to this committee, why is it that you would supersede where you are accountable and go to the minister?
I did not go directly to the minister. The chairman of the board received the report and she submitted it to the minister. I did not go directly to the minister.
Chairperson, thank you. I would like to continue. You were part and parcel of a meeting, which was a continuation meeting. It started in Kuwait and then it proceeded to another on the 12th of March, then on the 19th of March, and then on the 26th, finally the guillotine fell. And by the way, I must just make this point, Chairperson, and I hope you will not hold it against me. Ms. Geldenhuys, in your testimony before us today, it almost appears that you seem to be Pontius Pilate, that you are only the innocent sort of coordinator of the board meetings. You have a very specific duty in terms of the Companies Act and in terms of the SABC being a public broadcaster. Because anybody, and I would like to ask you, where you got the information that the Companies Act trumps the Broadcasting Act?
From the Companies Act itself. If you look at Section 5 of the Companies Act, it stipulates the legislation that must be that you have to comply with where there's a conflict or a difference between the legislation. Section 5 of the Companies Act does not include the Broadcasting Act. Over and above that, the Parliamentary Committee, Portfolio Committee on Communications, was provided with two legal opinions. I have included it in the copy of the documents that were submitted today. For Advocate Vanara, that the senior counsel who gave the information actually spells it out very clearly that the two acts actually can operate together.
Honourable Kilian, you'll have a second bite if there is. Your time is up. Honourable Mafango.
Chairperson, all I wanted to say, we do not agree with that. There was a very clear view in Parliament that was tabled in Parliament that the Broadcasting Act apply and that the Company Act only insofar as the Broadcasting Act is not elaborating on specific provisions such as the role of the Company Secretary. Chairperson, if there's a moment afterwards, I would gladly come back. Thank you.
Chair, thank you. The first question, Madam.
This statement that you've sent to us, you were responding to things that happened in during the sitting of the House, isn't it?
Yes.
In other words, it's not a statement of your role at SABC. It is your response to the matters that were raised before the committee. Who gave you that assignment?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Who gave you the assignment to respond to the matters that were raised here in the city?
This is my own response for myself, and the documents that I've given here are part of the documents that have been submitted to Parliament.
Mm-mm. I am saying this one. You crafted this in response
That's correct.
To the evidence presented here.
That is my own personal response for myself. That is the response that I wrote.
Who asked you to give us a response?
I was interviewed by Advocate Vanara to provide a statement to this committee.
Where is that statement?
Please may you ask that from Mr. Advocate Vanara.
So there's another statement. Now, why do you like this statement where you respond to ourselves? Are you aware that you were invited to sit here and query these people that were speaking here and not for you to write to the committee?
I wrote to Advocate Vanara.
No, you write?
Yes, I wrote to Advocate Vanara asking if I may be allowed to read my statement out here so that I could clarify matters that were raised and against the allegations against me.
No, I am saying you and your team were invited here.
I understand that.
Every time when we conclude a question to witnesses, we ask anyone from SABC to ask a query or speak. You decide and go and write us this thing. I think it's very responsible. Don't answer that question. The next question, are you aware that SABC is accountable to Parliament?
I'm fully aware of that.
What does accountability mean to you?
Accountability means that you come and you report and you do what is required and you make sure that you comply.
Hmm? How do you account for marching out of a sitting of Parliament? What do you call that?
I mentioned earlier that we did walk out in support of our chairperson who felt that he was not being treated constitutionally.
Are you aware that the chairperson was the last person to leave the house?
I was
and not the first?
I was walking behind the chairperson, so I must have gone out after him.
No. Mm-hmm. Are you aware that the chairperson was not leading the delegation when you left?
But I was walking behind the chairperson, so I didn't walk out first.
And everyone else was behind the chairperson?
No, I don't know who else was behind the chairperson, but I know I walked behind him.
You walked behind the chair?
Correct.
But who orchestrated the march out?
Chairman, the march out was...
It was not the chair. That's all I can say.
It was not me either, with due respect.
Who decided to interdict this process?
That was the chairman, as asked, with on the advice of his legal team.
Authority?
The authority was obviously from the chair that he's given it, because he's still a board member. Although the board was not correct at the time, he has the right, and the committee has said to him that he may take legal advice.
No, well, I know what we can say is you've been giving the chair all the wrong advices. Actually, all this mess that we are confronted with here, I think it is something that you should actually bear personally. Who is paying for the cost of this huge delegation?
That is not in my purview. I have not asked them or anything like
but
that.
But you spoke so about them earlier.
I spoke that they are here because I acknowledge the fact that they are here.
How long has this delegation been in Cape Town?
I don't know how long they've been here. I think not very long. I don't know.
What a coincidence. I love it.
I think they can answer for that.
They have not been invited. You spoke for them.
I said they were here in support, but I did not bring them here.
Do you know them?
I know them. I can see who they are. Yes, I know them. I know the.
How long have they been in Cape Town?
I don't know.
How long have you been in Cape Town?
I've been in Cape Town for the past week.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So when you left here, you didn't even go back to Pretoria. You were on holiday in Cape Town.
No, I was not on holiday. I was sitting and preparing documents, getting documents ready so that I could get them ready for the for submission.
And where was the chair?
The chair went back to Johannesburg, to Pretoria. We went back.
Okay. So you were alone here?
Yes.
You were alone?
I was alone.
Okay. And what were you doing?
I was busy preparing documents, getting all these documents that you've mentioned, the chairman mentioned, the amount of documents. It is a huge task to put together documents.
Which documents have you supplied us? Which document have you not supplied us?
I've only not supplied you with about 4 documents, because those are documents related.
Which documents have you not supplied
with? I've not supplied you with the round robins approving commercial processes.
Yeah, mention all of them.
Pardon?
Mention all of them.
The Uzalo case, the Mavangu, the scheme SOM, and that's all. That I think it's about 4 or 5 of them. And these 2 matters that relate to these security contract that was done, and the WAN of the business, because as an NKP, we have to be careful with the security matters of the SABC.
Who took the decision that you can now supply us with the rest of the documents which you refused to supply us with?
Please, may I correct you? I did not refuse to do anything with documents. That was not me that refused to give you the documents.
That's why I'm asking who?
I said to you before that on the advice of the legal team, the chairman listened to them and then agreed that until the committee was reconstituted, the documents would go.
And you have no role to advise the chair?
I did advise the chair.
What was your advice?
My advice to the chair was that he should come to this meeting. My advice to the chair was that he should comply with these things.
And he refused?
No, he did not. He listened to his legal team, who was the one giving him his advice. This is what he did.
Ms. Geldenhuys, please give us the name of that legal team. I'll come back to this question and I answer it. You have said 3 times his legal team advised him. Please give me the name of that legal team.
His legal team is Mr. Dukisho Incorporated.
Okay. Your current role, you said, what are you doing?
I am now the group executive for the governance and assurance division, which...
Are you responsible for risk? You're not.
The risk part falls under there. It's the risk department, the compliance department, the internal audit department, and the governance department.
Where do you derive thank your you, mandate
sir.
From?
Thank you, sir. You'll have another bite. Honorable Swartz. Okay.
Thank you, Chairperson. Ms. Geldenhuys. The meeting on the 14th of July 2014 that was called by SMS. Do you referred to that meeting earlier?
It's the 7th of July.
7th of July. Thank you for that correction. When the company secretary calls a meeting, surely you send out, there should be due notice for a meeting. Is that not the normal practice?
That's correct. But you will note that at that meeting, in the minutes of that meeting, when the constitution of the, in dealing with the constitution of the meeting, there was a request for board members to waive the required notice, which was duly done.
Thank you. That's the normal practice, though.
Correct.
So it seems that often, were there often meetings called without due notice being given?
There were a number of times where we had...
Why did you not object to that? Because that practice seems to be meetings called by SMSs urgently, and it seems that that is not correct, because board members have given evidence that they were not aware what the meeting was about.
The company secretary in that instance was also not aware of what the meeting was about.
But how is that possible, that you as the company secretary are not aware of what the meeting is about?
I asked the chairman, and she informed me that the public protector's report would be tabled and the matter of the COO.
Okay, thank you. Now... Mm-hmm.
But there were no documents. That was the only meeting that was urgently called by SMS.
Okay, but it had a huge impact, because it was the permanent appointment of Mr. Motsweneng.
Correct.
And you know the evidence that has come out in this inquiry about Mr. Motsweneng. You're aware you've been following that evidence?
I've heard about it, yes.
On your statement, did you discuss the contents of your statement with anybody else?
No, I have not.
Did you discuss the preparation of the statement with anyone else?
No, I have not.
The 17 members that are here?
Not one of them have been discussed.
Please give us the names of all the members that are here at your convenience, please, after this meeting. We'd like all the names and their positions. We'd like that. And who's paying for them to be here? Would you be aware of that?
They'd be able to tell you.
We'd like their names as well.
It's fine.
And I'd also like to know if it's the same members who walked out last week in our previous meeting, when we had the previous meeting.
I don't know who else is here
today. As far as you're able to.
Yes, as far as I'm able to. Thank you.
So the meeting that you had, a crucial meeting, where you're not aware of, you're given an agenda, you are the chairperson of the board, then the evidence is reads a letter from a legal firm recommending the full appointment of Mr. Motsoneng. Is that correct?
That's
you were
what,
at the meeting.
That's what proceeded at the meeting, yes.
Who wrote the legal... Who authored the letter, that legal letter?
I never had sight of the letter at the meeting.
But surely you
the
must have minuted it as to who were the author.
In the minutes, I can check up and see what the minutes were, but the chairman read out that letter to
and
the committee.
And it was Mr. Motsoneng's attorneys?
Correct.
That recommended him for the position.
Correct.
And that was against existing legislation and against no advertising, nothing. And I'm sure you objected to that process as the company secretary.
Had I been informed of the process that was going to be followed at that meeting, I would have advised Mrs. Shabalala differently. I would have told her not to do this.
But as the meeting... I'm sorry to interrupt you because I've got limited time.
Okay.
I really apologize.
No problem.
But... As the meeting unfolds, you see things are going against existing legislation. Surely at that stage, you should exercise and object and say, this is against, there's been no advertising of this position. Did you do that?
There were a number of board members that were already doing that.
No, but it's your responsibility.
I know it's my responsibility.
Did you do it?
The only thing I could do is to say that this process is not correct.
Can I just read what Mr. Professor Kumala said this morning?
Yes.
Bongani Kumala. He says, the SABC has a good company secretariat. Miss Theresa Geldenhuys' authority, however, was undermined and disabled.
I agree with that completely, and that is
But that doesn't distract from the fact that you've still got an obligation.
It doesn't. And
so in other words, you are not doing your job correctly.
It's
would
not
you not agree with that?
I will not agree fully with that. It's
but
not
you would agree to a certain degree?
Correct.
To what degree? 50%?
To the degree.
Sorry, would you just answer 50%?
In the past, when we had the previous chairperson, I would say 100%.
You'd say
yes.
What, 20%, now, 10%?
Now it's the board members that prevent me from talking. That is not the chairperson.
And in other words, you are not able to comply with your statutory duties.
No,
but you've been promoted to a new position.
Can I please respond to you, Mr.
Yes.
Honourable Spot? I disagree that I am not able to comply with my duties. I have been, and I've mentioned in there that regardless of the fact that I've been told that I must not talk and that I'm only the company secretary, I've continued to provide the advice that is required.
Okay, but I think... And did you ever indicate the fact that you wanted to resign?
I actually did resign. I actually did put in my resignation for that specific reason, because I felt that my integrity was being compromised.
I resigned
for that.
Professor Bongani said that you were in fact browbeaten. In other words, you were bullied by
correct.
Other members of the board. Is that correct?
That
who
is absolutely
who bullied you?
Correct.
Was it the COO?
No. At
who
no
bullied
stage,
you? Was it not the CEO at all?
It was not the CEO at
all.
Did
he not bully you at all?
I wouldn't say that he ever bullied me.
So, did
it
he never...
It was the non-executive directors who always did bully.
That's very interesting, because that's the one side of the faction that has come out very clearly in the board. Was it the members that were suspended that bullied you?
No. It was the member that I mentioned previously, Ms. Mshlagaza, that bullied me. That kept saying that I have no right to speak.
Mr. Naidu, did he bully you?
Mr. Naidu, too, has said
and
to
me... And he's happened to be suspended and fired as well.
Mr. Naidu was never suspended or fired. Mr. Naidu resigned on the 5th of October in Parliament.
Well, he left under very... You heard his evidence that he was complaining about the issues of governance.
That's right, but he was not complaining about his role in preventing me from talking, which, although he said on several occasions, keep quiet, you're not supposed to talk. And then he comes back and says that I did not give the advice that's required.
Who else would have browbeaten you?
It was those two members.
Who's the other member?
Ms. Mshlagaza.
And she also resigned?
She resigned, yes.
So the persons that are remained did not browbeat you at all?
She was one of the board members who remained and resigned.
Ms. Shabalala, did she browbeat you at all?
Oh, yes.
But why didn't you mention her?
But I said in the previous 100% I was being browbeaten.
Thank you very much.
I'm only starting,
I know you were starting.
That's our challenge, is to get to the bottom. Yeah. And I hope you appreciate.
Let me warn. No. Let me again advise members, prioritize your questions. I've given you extra 7 minutes because I cannot deviate from 7 minutes. I will stop you on 7 minutes. Honorable Khoza.
Thank you, Chair, and good afternoon, Madam Geldenhuys.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, maybe let me start by acknowledging your many outstanding academic accomplishments. And ma'am, I also wanted to particularly recognize the fact that you also hold an international board governance, which you obtained with a cum laude, that's distinction. And ma'am, can you advise us which institution gave you?
University of Johannesburg.
Thank you very much, ma'am. I just want you to be monosyllabic in the following questions that I'm going to ask you. Yes, no, or whatever, but I want you to be monosyllabic. Is there a deficit between your moral conscience and your academic accolades?
No.
Thank you. Are you honest?
I try my best to be, yes.
Okay. Would you classify yourself as a victim or victor?
I will not allow myself to be a victim. I prefer to be a victor.
Thank you, ma'am. Do you have integrity?
Absolutely.
In your moral compass, where do you locate moral principles? Are they in the periphery or at the core of your being?
It's at the core of my being.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, ma'am, as a company secretary, you are a chief administrative officer. Is that correct?
Correct.
And your key role is to advise the board and members of the board.
Correct.
Is that correct?
Correct.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, would you concede that with all these accolades, under your watch, being at SABC, the institution completely failed in terms of governance in every respect possible?
No, I will not concede to that, because not in every respect is there.
Okay, ma'am,
governance.
Thank you. In your view, the staff, your top executive, the exodus of skills in SABC, is that a normal occurrence?
It's not a normal process.
Okay. And do you think the AG audit opinion is consistent with good corporate governance?
In terms of corporate governance, there's a difference between the governance of the company and the failures in terms of the operating.
Ma'am, you've agreed that your role is to advise the chair and to advise the board.
Correct.
Thank you, ma'am. I just don't want you to waste most of my time. Under your watch, ma'am, staff members were pinched. Some of them lost income to a point where their families are suffering. Are you happy with that record, ma'am? As a fundi and an expert in corporate governance, internationally acclaimed for that matter.
May I please expand on that? Because okay. I am not the person who purges anybody. I am not the authority that can do that.
And ma'am, you said you are not a victim. You are a victim.
No, I'm not a victim.
When your executive, the other executive, exercised their choice, they decided to leave when they couldn't take it anymore. You decided to leave, but you came back. And that was also a promotion because you became the GE governance and assurance.
Now, please, may I correct you? I did not resign this week or last week. I resigned at the time when Ellen Shabalala was the board chairperson.
And ma'am, you stayed on from that time until now.
I stayed on.
Okay, ma'am, let's not waste any more time. The final question from me. I just want you to go on page one of your statement. Let's go to paragraph four. Let me read what you've written here. I point out that although I am not a lawyer, the study of corporate and commercial law, the Companies Act and the Income Tax Act, amongst other legislation, are compulsory requirements of my qualifications. This has provided me with the requisite knowledge to deal with companies and the relevant laws with which they must comply, thus enabling me to provide accurate and reliable guidance to the boards on which I have worked as the company secretary. I have 26 years experience as a company secretary, of which more than 18 years has been in state-owned entities, the public sector. Ma'am, you are under oath. Do you still stand by the statement?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Done. Honourable Mukwena.
Thanks, Chair. Are you well, ma'am?
Fine, thank you.
Do you still have any business dealings in whatever capacity, secretary or whatever, with Mr. Motsoeneng?
I have no business dealings at all with Mr. Motsoeneng.
Well, you were in a company with him as secretary.
The company is the subsidiary of the SABC. It is not a private company or a personally held company.
That's fine, but you've got nothing else with him.
Exactly.
No. Okay, no problem. I just wanted to check also, just before I get into my paper, who paid for Mr. Motsoeneng to be here in the last meeting that you staged or walked out?
I don't know who paid for him, and that is a fact. Who paid, I have no idea.
Okay, no problem. I'm not satisfied with your explanation that you are the company secretary. You are at the core of compliance at the SABC. Things go wrong. People get dismissed illegally. Some of the dismissals, you see them on TV, as you said, and there's no response from you. You don't write to the minister. You don't write to the chairperson. You don't write to anyone. All of this flies over you, and you're the company secretary, and you do nothing.
What am I supposed to do? And please don't get me wrong. Let me finish my question.
No problem.
What would you prefer that I do? As the company secretary, I can provide guidance to the board. I cannot go and tell executives in whatever process they are following to do what they're doing with the executives,
whether it's purging
or whether they have a reason to release these individuals. It is not for me to tell them you can't do that.
Let me give you an example, ma'am. Mr. Motsoeneng, at a meeting in which you say that the public protector's report was going to be discussed and the second issue was going to be Mr. Motsoeneng's appointment.
No, the second issue was just the CEO. The matter of whether it was his appointment or not was not known.
Your role as company secretary is to be at the meeting, in fact, to organize the meeting, to be
correct.
At the meeting, and also
correct.
To advise on the meeting. Is
correct.
That correct?
Mm-hmm.
Were you present at that meeting?
I was present at the meeting, yes.
Okay, now in that meeting, it was discussed that Mr. Motsoeneng must be appointed permanently as the COO. At that time, the SABC was in possession of the public protector's report.
Correct.
Did you not see any legal misgivings in that decision and then advise the board that that decision was illegal?
If you recall, as was rightly pointed out by one of the honourable members, I was railroaded.
Okay.
And that now, is something
I'm willing to accept that, ma'am, and I recall that very well. But let me ask you, do you not have a computer and an email, anything that you can write on and advise the board through an email? Just for your record, you're a legal person. You know, in legal capacity, things have to be in black and white. You have to cover yourself legally. You're a legal appointment. How do we know that you advised on any of these matters?
The record of the minutes will be able to show you where I have advised the board.
Did you advise the board on the public protector report?
I did not advise the board on the public protector report. I did give them information in terms of what the processes that were followed within the SABC for supporting documents for what had to be reviewed at the various
committees. So you did not advise the board that appointing Mr. Motsweneng as permanent COO was against the public protector's report remedial action?
The statement again, I reiterate, I was railroaded at those meetings and could not tell the chairman that she could not do what was being done.
And you could not write afterwards to explain, to give them a legal...
What I did do was resign because I said my integrity has been compromised and I do not wish to be part of that proceedings.
Who advised you not to hand in the documents that Parliament was asking for the purposes of this ad hoc committee?
As I said earlier, the attorneys of the chairman advised him that these documents must be held back until the interdict.
So you got an opinion from the legal advisors?
I did not get an opinion. I was instructed from the chair's side that I cannot
so
release
the
document.
That's the question I was asking you.
The chairperson got the instruction. Yes.
Thank you very much. That's how you must answer. You must say the chair, not give me an explanation of the background of who did what. Because it sounds like you're protecting the chair.
No, I'm
protecting you, actually.
Thank you.
Okay. Now, on the 18th, this is my last one, Chair. On the 18th of November 2015,
yes.
At the meeting, a meeting at which Mr. Franz Matlala was dismissed, were you present at the meeting?
I was present where they approved
the dismissal.
Yes.
You had 9 members there at that meeting, 2 of which were 2 executives. Mr. Jimmy Matthews.
Correct.
And Mr. Saudi Motsweneng.
I don't know if Mr. Motsweneng was there. If you can look at
the
minutes.
I have information that the COO, the acting COO,
was there.
And the acting CEO were there.
Okay, because when Mr. Jimmy Matthews was the acting CEO, if I recall correctly, there was the time when Mr. Motsweneng was on leave for his disciplinary committee.
That is fine. So let's just assume that that Mr. Saudi was not there. Mr. Jimmy Matthews was at the meeting.
Yes.
And you allowed a meeting in which the acting CEO, the acting general CEO, who was a subject, so to speak, in the hierarchy, to the person who was being dismissed, to sit in that meeting and to vote. Did you not see any conflict of interest there?
When a person is appointed as an acting capacity, an acting executive director, they have the full powers of that position.
But in this case, the position that was being contested here was somebody who was either equal in your explanation or beneath.
Okay.
Do you not see a conflict of interest?
It was not a conflict of interest because Mr. Matthews would not have been appointed as the permanent GCO because the process to recruit a permanent GCO would be outside of him being there in his acting capacity.
But do you concede that had you seen a conflict of interest there,
it would be
Mr. Matlala would not have been dismissed?
No, I cannot say that. Because Mr. Matlala's dismissal has nothing to do with the appointment of Mr. Matthews as the acting GCO. That was a separate matter.
Thank you, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Honorable Nkwanka.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. I wish to go back to an issue, your response to the regular appointment of the COO, Mr. Claudine Swenning, without following due process. Your response to a question earlier, you said you were not given an opportunity to advise.
Correct.
Right? Now, as a person whose primary mandate is to provide advice and guidance as per your submission to us, which says accurate advice, provide accurate and reliable guidance, weren't you even supposed, even after then, to provide that advice? I'll tell you why I'm asking you that question once you've answered it quickly. I'm saying, as a company secretary, yes, you have, whether that advice is being sought or not, but your duty is to make sure that you provide that guidance, even if you do so after the event. To say, here are the issues, here are the blind spots, here are the limitations and some of the risks of what you're trying to undertake. Say, if you don't do it in the meeting, you could have even done it after that, to give pointers to the board.
You can get that pointers from the chairperson that is currently in this meeting, because I have mentioned to them outside of the meeting of the process that is followed. And with, again, I reiterate, when you try to deal with matters at the board and you are shot down all the time when you're telling them that that is the wrong procedure and that is the wrong process, then what choice do you have? I made a decision to leave. I made a decision to resign. And I was persuaded that I should not go. And that was an undertaking was given that the processes would be improved, that that will not continue to happen where my integrity is compromised.
Thank
you,
Mama.
That is the reason I stayed.
There is no, I'm asking you that question. Then it means when you answer that question, you are not accurate. You didn't answer it the way you're doing right now. Because when you're saying advice was not sought, it means you didn't give it. Now you're saying you did give advice, but it was not accepted. And that's something completely different. Because by saying the advice was not sought and then you left it there, you're basically saying you didn't do your job. Right? Now you're saying you did your job, but no one listened to you. The second issue is, once the memorandum of incorporation, I think this question was asked again, and I didn't hear a clear response from you. Once it was amended, were the powers to appoint and discipline staff and members of the SABC management team were delegated to the GCO, CFO, and whatnot. Once the negative effect of that became apparent, through obviously a number of staff members and senior executives leaving, what advice did you provide to the board about the impact of that decision and what they needed to do in order to try and correct it? Did you sit back, keep quiet, and allow things to roll?
You give me more credit than what I have been allowed to have. Nevertheless, I can only say to you that the Memorandum of Incorporation is the statutory document that was provided. My duty as the company secretary is to ensure that there's compliance with such documents. It is not my duty. As was mentioned earlier, I don't have the authority to instruct the chair of the minister on what to do.
The issue is about being able to point the board to the unintended consequences of the amendment to the clause. I'm not saying you should have told them. That is the point we're trying to make, because that goes together, obviously, with the amendments to DEF and what ended up happening to the procurement policies and the procurement division of SABC. And that is primarily the problem that we want to point your attention to. But I want to go back to something you said on page one, where I think it was correctly pointed out that it was not your place to comment on the input and what the parliamentarians were saying on that particular day. You were given a particular mandate. But do you realize that as parliament, what we do, we're doing it in terms of the constitution. We have a constitutional mandate to do what we're doing. We have a constitutional mandate to oversee the work of the institutions, including that of the executive. Do you agree with that?
I agree.
At what point then did you think that by being robust in what we're talking about, that we should be we have a responsibility sort of to mollycoddle entities that includes yourselves when we deal with you on matters of accountability on state resources?
I did not expect to be mollycoddled. and I do not expect you to mollycoddle any institution. We have a chairman who is not able to see the way you and I can, and it is out of respect for him that it was requested that he be provided earlier with documents so that he could utilize the Braille system to convert it for him to be able to respond.
Now, if you were not able to provide advice and guidance to the board on many instances which were also highlighted by my colleagues, on what basis then were you promoted? Because it then means that you did not do your job as a company secretary. On what basis were you appointed to your new role?
It was definitely not a promotion. It is a straight side appointment. There's no promotion included in that. It actually, the basis is that I am, our governance is failing in the SABC because the processes and procedures are not implemented correctly. We have, in terms of what we do in our audit committee and our risk, not our audit, our internal audit and our risk, they have to talk to each other because we base our audits on the risk processes that are done. The same with our compliance. All of these functions do not talk to each other at this point, or previously they were not talking to each other. There's more stringent requirements coming in terms of the King 4, and the intention was that we strengthen these divisions, that they can work together more closely without compromising the integrity of any of the divisions.
Thank you for that, Mama. I sympathize with you. I understand that we cannot blame everything on you. However, if you were not effective in your previous role, I don't understand how you can be rewarded by being shifted to another position within the same entity.
I'm sorry, but I don't think it was a reward. It's more of a punishment than a reward. Yes. But regardless of that, you cannot say to me that I was ineffective in my job, because the work that I've done is proof enough that I was effective.
Well, from where I'm sitting, you are not, but no, I think that's the debate for another day. Thank you, Chairperson.
You see the one side. Okay.
Very much. Ma'am Geldenhuys, one of your primary roles as the company secretary, I would imagine, is to organize board meetings. Is that correct?
That's correct.
On the instruction of the chair?
Correct.
So the chair asks you to organize a board meeting, and you're saying to this committee that the only thing you knew about it was something said COO.
Correct.
How do you expect the board members to prepare if you're saying that? And, let's put it to you differently. Do you think it's the proper thing to call board members to a meeting that just says COO?
I do not think that it's the proper
way. Did you allow it to happen?
Because, I again reiterate, I was instructed that you will call this meeting as an emergency meeting, as an urgent special meeting. You will send out the agenda. When I asked what is the agenda item, I was told that the one item is public protector and the second item is the matter of the COO.
Do you accept that in hindsight, it was not correct for you to send out an agenda that says COO, no documents for them to prepare? Do you accept in hindsight that you could have done it differently? Yes or
if
no?
If I had known what was going to be the discussion.
No, I'm saying to you.
In hindsight, yes.
Yes.
On that basis,
right.
I do.
You get to the meeting. A decision is taken to appoint the COO totally against every rule in the book, and you admitted that. Don't you think it was your duty to have said to the board what you are doing is wrong?
As I said to you, I've mentioned that, and that was disregarded.
All right. I wanted you to say that. So you advise the board. The board does the wrong thing. They jump over the cliff. You jumped over the cliff with them. You're saying to us, you advised the board did the wrong thing, and you, till today, have not raised that with anybody else, that the board did the wrong thing at the time, until you come to this committee to admit it. You've never said to anybody, on that day, the board did the wrong thing, I advised them, and I had no power to do it. It takes a commission for you to say, I saw the board doing the wrong thing and I was powerless to do anything about it. And you're the company secretary?
I cannot comment on what you're saying, because unless you're in that situation and you are there participating in what is happening, you can from this side make a statement like that.
No, you can't. This country is governed by laws. The law says you must do X. You can't come to me and say to me, because I was bullied by Y, I chose not to do the correct thing. You can't say I was on that side. And you broke the law. And maybe not you explicitly, but you were complicit in breaking the law. So you can't turn around and say I was bullied, I had nothing to do, and unless you're on this side, you'll never understand. It can't work that way. You either stand up and you say to everybody, it is wrong, and therefore I distance myself from it, but you can't come to Parliament and say you were browbeaten, and therefore you are allowed for the law to be broken. Do you agree with me?
I agree with you.
Let's go to the next point, ma'am. You're the company secretary. One of your responsibilities is to advise the board on relevant legislation. The Companies Act, well, let's start with the Companies Act. Let's start with the PFMA. That's relevant legislation.
Correct.
Section 50C of the PFMA says that the board must, on request, provide all material facts and documents to the minister and everybody and Parliament. The law says they must. And I'm accepting that you're the company secretary and that you should understand that law. The shareholders' compact, which was signed less than 8 months ago by the chairperson of the board, I'll give you the exact date in a minute. And I'm assuming that you would have had sight of this document, the shareholders' compact that governs how you do your business, signed by the chairperson, Mr. McGouvey, on the 26th of April, 2016. It says 3.41, the board. The board controls the affairs of the SABC, is accountable to Parliament for compliance by the SABC with the Broadcasting Act. And I'm expecting that you understand that it's accountable to Parliament. So you know all those things. And then the legal advisor for the board, chairperson, says to you, don't comply with Parliament. Don't give them the documents they want. Lucky Tsakiso says that. The legal advice of the board advises the board to break the law. You are the advisor to the board. You're aware that his legal advice is telling him to break the law. Hold on. And then you come here and you say to us that you were browbeaten, you were powerless, it was the board. What did you do when you saw somebody breaking the law?
The only time I can say that the law was broken, as you put it, is the time where the policies in terms of the HR recruitment was not followed. In terms of the document submission, there was a case going on here. There was an interdict that was presented in Cape Town, and they were waiting for the outcome of the interdict. And in my meager knowledge of law, could be that you have to wait for the outcome of the case before you can.
Let me stop you, ma'am. When was the court case with Judge Desai? Do you remember the date?
I think it was the 8th. No, it was before.
It was the 3rd.
The 3rd of December.
This letter is dated the 6th.
Correct.
The court case had already been thrown out.
Yes.
You're saying to us there was still a court case going on?
There was an appeal.
There was no appeal. That's on the 6th, there was no appeal. The court case has been thrown out. the legal advice gives him wrong advice, breaks the law, and you're coming to say to Parliament that, well, there was an appeal going on. I'm reminding you that you're speaking under oath.
I know, I remember.
Do you want to repeat and say that the reason why you kept quiet was because you think that there was a court case that was preventing Parliament from getting the documents? Is that what you're saying to me?
I'm saying that there was an attempt, or if it didn't get finalized, there was going to be an appeal against the hearing.
I'm asking you. I don't want to know what was... You didn't know at that point whether the appeal was going to be successful or not. You still don't know whether that appeal is successful or not. The legal advisor advises the chairperson to break the law. At that point, you are the company secretary. You are supposed to say to the chairperson, that advice is actually not solid advice.
The one thing that I can say to you is, in the discussion with the chairperson, I did say to him, Chair, we need to start giving these documents. And you will note that on the 6th of December, a number of documents were sent to the committee.
Ma'am, I'm not going to belabor this point. Safe to say that that letter of the 6th that I'm talking about came to us and said the following documents will not be provided.
Correct.
Now, I want to remind you for the last time that if you don't know your facts, it's better you keep quiet than to say something that you will regret. This letter, listen to me, this letter says, let me start where I should. It's dated the 6th, it's from Lucky Tsakiso. We have advised Theresa Geldenhuys to email certain documents. We have advised her, so you're aware of it. Mm-hmm. It then goes on and says, the following documents will not be provided.
Correct.
No ambiguity about that. I am saying to you that that provision, that documents will not be provided to Parliament, is against the law. What did you do about it?
I continued to discuss with the chairperson, and you will note that 3 days after that letter was sent, we started sending the other documents. I started getting the rest of the documents out to you.
My final question, and then I'll allow members to carry on. Ma'am, no, two more questions, and I'll allow people to carry on. Part of the Broadcasting Act says that the board must establish and maintain libraries. Are you aware of that?
Establish and?
Must establish and maintain libraries. Are you aware of that portion in the...
I don't get the last part. Establish and maintain?
Establish and maintain libraries.
Yes.
Are you aware of that provision in the...
Yes, there's an act, yes.
You are aware of it?
Yes.
When the SABC sold the library to Multi-choice. When they sold the library to Multi-choice, did you advise them that they're breaking provisions of the public?
But they did not sell the library.
What did they do?
The use of the broadcasting of the archive material is what they've done. It still remains the property of the SABC. And if you recall, in the free-to-air agreement that there is, those programs are broadcasted for free in any event on the platform of...
No, they're not broadcast for free, ma'am.
The normal...
Hold on.
Sorry,
no. Yeah. Channel 161, that ENCO channel, or whatever it is on DSTV, is it not?
Correct.
Millions of South Africans can't afford DSTV. That's economical exclusion. Do you agree with me?
Those are our archive programs.
Yes, I'm talking about the archive.
Yes, it's our archive programs that would not be broadcast on TV 1, 2, or 3 in any event. These are what is there. These different programs being broadcast on the one channels 1, 2, and 3.
Why will DSTV want material that is no use to you? What's the use it's going to be today?
I'm not saying
You're saying we're not going to use it?
I'm not saying that we're not
What are you saying?
I'm saying that currently, that is from our archives. The current programs that are on are there. The intention is that once DTT is implemented, that platform will revert to the SABC. So it's not been sold. We are getting money for them airing it, as opposed to the normal free-to-air process that goes that happens.
Right, my final question, ma'am. You agreed, and the court agreed, and everybody agreed that there is no board that has the power to take any decisions.
At this point, yes.
You agree?
Correct.
SABC is continuing with its business. Money is being spent. People are working and probably expect salaries. On whose authority are we going to spend the next cent of SABC when there is no accounting authority? On whose authority is going to? And have you advised them that what they are doing, since the board has been incorrect, has the potential of exposing the SABC and everything that it does, because there is no accounting authority that can take decisions? Have you advised them accordingly?
Yes, I have.
What have they done about it?
This is the process that has been followed over here. There's nothing that this SABC can do until we have an accounting authority. What has happened, we have a bigger problem too. The acting authority of the CFO is also going to expire, so is the authority of the GCO, because we do not have a board.
So you're saying to South Africans that until such time that we have a board of correct standing, there's nothing we're going to do other than to continue to expose SABC to whatever there is? I'm not saying you're doing it. I'm trying to understand for everybody else.
Exactly.
You're saying to me, indeed, there is this real exposure. It's not of your making.
Correct, but the...
What is the contingency plan for all of us?
For all of us, at this stage, the SABC has a delegation of authority framework within which there are certain levels that approval can be done. However, outside of us now having... When the authority of the group executive, acting group executive, expires, we will have a major problem. And this is of great concern, because how are we going to operate without having our group executive, chief executive? We have a CFO, we don't have a COO, and we will not have an acting GCO if the process is not corrected.
You never deemed that necessary to tell Parliament that, ladies and gentlemen, we are approaching a situation where we're going to be in deep trouble? You, as a patriotic South African, I'm not even talking to you as a company secretary, because you are on the rock face. You didn't think it necessary to say to anybody, the current trajectory is going to lead us to a real crisis. You didn't think it was necessary.
The minister has been informed of that situation. The minister is aware of it.
When did you inform the minister?
The minister has been informed, and I'm sure the CFO was, the acting GCO has informed her, because as the protocol goes, I don't deal directly with the minister.
I'll allow for two questions if there's any. Right. We're going to run late. We're going to finish at 5:30. I'm going to allow everybody 1 minute each, or one question each. One question each. Can I do it this way, that, and I hope you take notes, ma'am, because otherwise we're going to have too much time. Everybody has one question. We will note the questions and we'll ask company secretary to try and respond. Can we start with you, Mr. McQuinn? Just one question. We move on to Kwankwa, move on to that way. Just one question. Please note the questions and we'll allow you time to respond. Sir.
Ma'am, you said the minister was informed of the deteriorating situation at the SABC. When you are then asked when was she informed, you then say the GCEO must have told. Was she informed or not?
No. I said one question.
Did you ever inform your principals about the state or the poor state of governance at SABC? If you asked that question, did you follow it up with clear recommendations of how to improve the situation? Thank you so much.
Chair, with me, it's just a comment for you to take home and sleep over it. I think you have betrayed what corporate governance is all about. And I must say that I'm very, very disappointed about you. And I think South Africans have witnessed somebody who is a pathetic liar. Thank you.
No. That's no. Can you withdraw the last statement, ma'am?
Withdraw that, Chair. But safe to say that I have found you not to be a trustable witness. Thank you.
Honourable Swartz.
I just wanted you to take a quick note about the ICASA ruling relating to the complaints about the protest. You remember that there was the ICASA ruling that the SABC may not almost censor the protest coverage. And in view of your role and compliance with legislation, are you aware that there are now criminal charges that have been laid against the SABC for non-compliance with ICASA's recommendations and resolutions in terms of Section 17H of the ICASA Act?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Mr. Mahlangu?
Chair, assuming that Madam here is the owner of the National Key Point SABC, because that's what she said, that she's responsible for risk. What I want to know, whether she's vetted and whether senior managers are also vetted.
Part of your duties in terms of the SABC charter is the training of incoming board members. Having seen the way the term of this board has played out, do you think you've properly discharged that of that duty? And why should this committee not recommend that you be dismissed immediately from your position?
What will be of benefit in this incorporation or the working together of SABC and MultiChoice? Who's gonna end up benefiting?
Thank you, Chair. The meeting of the 7th of July, the irregular appointment of the COO, the minutes don't reflect anywhere that you have provided advice to the board to be cautious about the proceeding with the appointment. You say you were browbeaten, but it's not reflected in any way in your minutes that you actually took the step of giving advice to the board not to proceed.
What date was this? What? Which meeting? So that she's...
It was the 7th of July, Chairperson.
7th of July meeting.
And I take it that Ms. Geldenhuys is responsible for keeping and maintaining the minutes based on the transcript of the meeting.
Honourable Chauke, you have the last say.
Chair, I think that I don't have anything for you, ma'am, anymore. The fact is that I don't find the truth in all what you have just said. So, thank you.
Honourable members, that is going to be the end of our session with Ms. Geldenhuys. Ms. Geldenhuys, there's at least 6 questions. I'm hoping you took note of them. If you could respond to them, please, ma'am.
May I first respond to the fact that it's alleged that I'm not honest. I cannot understand why that has been done. It's been laid at my feet all along that what the board has done is my fault because I'm not giving them information or giving them advice. I find that a very unfair statement and a very inaccurate statement as well. Having said that, I will proceed to answer the questions that were raised. The minister is supposed to be the one that's informed, and the GCO is the next in line to be able to tell him that. The GCO is aware that the acting positions are expiring, so are the incumbents in those positions that they will be expiring. I have not spoken to the CFO, the acting GCO, to confirm whether or not he has already informed the minister, but he has been advised of this and that he needs to inform the minister. I have not had an opportunity to talk to him, to ask him if it has already been done. Okay, is that... the poor state of governance. I would like you to have a look at the entire SABC and note that there's been tremendous improvements in various areas in governance. The fact that there are governance failures, particularly in terms of the board, is not the at the foot of myself being in that position. The work that I've done was in order to uplift and to strengthen governance throughout the organization and not only at the board level. Completely betrayed, I really find that a very harsh statement. I do not believe that I've betrayed anything in corporate governance. I believe that I've done my work with integrity, as I continue to do. And what has been done by me has been done with honesty and without taking sides. In the Inkasa ruling, I am not the legal department of the SABC. Our legal department will deal with those issues, not this company secretary. Any matters relating to cases and legal proceedings go through our legal department. Vetted as manager, when I started at the SABC, my vetting was in terms of the vetting that is done by the employment agencies that we go through. That was about exactly what you're referring to. Any further vetting, I am open to that vetting, as was mentioned here by Ms. Corsi, that because people's contracts do not include the vetting, there's been a kickback against vetting being done in the sense that they have to be done to get the clearance level 1 or top secret, etc. type of clearance. I've just started in this role. In the time that I've been there now, I do not mind to be vetted. I am open to be vetted. In fact, it is a requirement that I have to be vetted if I'm going to be working with the NKP Act. It is compulsory for me to be vetted, so I have nothing against being vetted at all. The rest of the management, as I mentioned, because of the contracts, employment contracts, not including the requirement for them to be vetted, it is a struggle because unions are kicking against something like that happening with the employees. New employees are supposed to be vetted, and that is the instruction from the board to the HR department that all new employees have to go through a proper vetting process. Training of the board, I've taken the board through an in-depth induction program in the year that they started. Since then, it's been pushed against all the time. Whenever an induction program is arranged, it's minuted as well in the various minutes that I've been told we leave it until the new members are being appointed. We had a scheduled meeting for 2014 where it was a 3-day breakaway where the strategy was going to take place as well as board induction, which would have been supposed to be for the full day so that the board could be properly inducted. That meeting was cancelled. And since then to now, every time I want to do an induction, there has been resistance to me to providing an induction. Who will benefit from the multi-choice? I'm sorry, that is not something that I can answer because I don't know what you mean by who will benefit. I certainly don't benefit from the multi-choice agreement. The fact that Member Kilian, Honourable Kilian, has spoken about, we do not add every single thing in the minutes, especially that minute you will see that was very detailed. And the fact that I mentioned earlier, when I raised the concerns, right, it was not inside the meeting, during the meeting, because when you try to stop something, you get railroaded. And I reiterate, you get railroaded outside of the meeting. And I mentioned that this is one of the reasons that I did resign, because my integrity was being compromised. And then the other one is nothing. Honourable Chalky had nothing more to say. Pardon?
No, you protected, ma'am. No, don't do that.
You can fire me if you want.
No, you're being protected, ma'am. Don't.
No, if that.
Hold on. I'm chairing this meeting. Okay. I would like you to talk
Thank
through
you.
Me.
No, I'll talk
And
to
everybody
you.
Else to talk through me. We've come to the end of that session, Madam Geldenhuys. Just a question, you know, I and really there's nothing personal. This is our duty, constitutional responsibility. You've continuously said in this meeting that I wanted to do the right thing and the board kicked against it, whether it's the training and all those type of things. You're transferring skills to the young lady next to you. How are you advising her what to do when she encounters this thing? Because you see, I can understand the power dynamics. You are an employee or you're accountable to the board. The board then chooses just to ignore you because you, Theresa Geldenhuys, or they kick against you and so on. And we end up with the situation that we're in now because you're supposed to be advising them. And you're transferring skills to this young lady. I mean, just very briefly, so that at least Parliament has comfort that we've learned from this lesson. When the next board starts kicking against what she is supposed to do, what advice are you giving her and us so that we can proactively ensure that the SABC never sinks to the level where it sunk now? What advice are you giving her?
May I be frank?
Yes.
I would request that the Parliament employs or appoints directors who are more proficient in the being directors, that experienced people are there, and that the monitoring, because if you look at everything else, who recommended the appointments of these directors?
No, that's fine. I think we must be man enough as Parliament also to acknowledge our own mistakes where they are. We must, and I'm not taking anybody's side, but we take the point. Just before I close off, I'm looking at those officials that are sitting there. In my other life, I serve in Scopa. We don't ever want to see a delegation as big as that. We don't ever want to see a delegation as big as that coming to sit in Parliament, not saying a word at taxpayers' money. We are not asking you, we are telling you. Don't ever come anymore as 17 people to observe at taxpayers' money. Fruitless, wasteful, and the accounting authority will carry the can. So I'm saying to you as senior executive, don't do it. Don't do it. The second point I want to make. At the press conference, after you walked out on the 7th, I am informed that one amongst you said that kangaroo court about these people here. Now, if you're there, I want you to stand up and apologize that you said Parliament is a kangaroo court. If you are amongst there, if there is nobody amongst there, we will do a follow-up. I am reliably informed somebody said that kangaroo court, referring to this committee. If you are there, I suggest you stand up and apologize to Parliament. If you didn't say it, then you're fine. So you've got a chance to make amends if you refer to Parliament as a kangaroo court, or certainly as this committee as a kangaroo court, at your press conference of the 7th of December. Anybody said that, you better apologize. Yes, sir.
I mentioned kangaroo court, Chair.
In what context did you mention kangaroo court?
I said this looks more like a kangaroo court.
Who are you, sir?
Mohlololi Park.
I'm saying, in what capacity are you an employee of SABC?
I am an employee of the SABC.
Yeah. In what capacity?
Executive HR.
I want you to withdraw unconditionally that you even put Parliament and Kangaroo Court in one sentence. Unconditionally withdraw that statement.
I withdraw.
We will break for 5 minutes and we'll carry on with the chairperson thereafter.
Well, you're watching SABC News. News today, of course, we are live from Johannesburg, South Africa. What you're seeing now, visuals of day five of the inquiry, parliamentary ad hoc committee inquiry into the SABC.